Okay, first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to present my work in this wonderful conference. I'm going to talk about topological strings, resurgence, and quantum mechanics. And this is based on some work I have done with my former student, Santico De Sido, Ricardo Schiappa, and my former student, Alba Grassi. So let me give you some motivation. In recent years, it has become clear that in some backgrounds, not all of them, but in some backgrounds, topological string theory is closely related to quantum mechanical theories and to quantum integral systems. And this relationship has led to very interesting developments. In particular, it has led to non-perturbative definitions of topological string theories on toric backgrounds, for example, and I reviewed some of these applications in my talk in string math in 2016. Now, unfortunately, the quantum systems that are involved in this correspondence are not always elementary. Now, what I would like to do in this talk is to discuss applications of topological string theory to very basic models in quantum mechanics. And this, I hope, will turn out to set new light on all the classical problems in quantum mechanics. So let's then go back to real basics, and let's look at what are arguably the simplest models in quantum mechanics. Now, the simplest models in quantum mechanics are probably one-dimensional Hamiltonians, where you have a standard kinetic term, P squared, and then you have a potential term which is just a degree m polynomial. And x and p are standard Heisenberg operators commuted to IH bar. Now, of course, we all learn in undergrad quantum mechanics that when n is equal to 2, you can solve this problem exactly. And when n is bigger or equal than 3, there is no easy explicit solution. Also, these problems, when n is bigger or equal than 3, are one of the most interesting quantum mechanical problems. For example, the cubic oscillator is arguably the simplest system in which you have resonant states and tunneling. And let me also mention historically that the qubit potential is the first example ever studied in quantum mechanics. This was the example that Heisenberg studied in his paper in 1925. Now, another interesting case is when n equals 4, you can have a symmetric double well with a quartic potential. And this also has a very interesting non-partitive phenomenon, which is the restoring of parity symmetry breaking due to instanton effects. So these are very, very crucial and basic models in quantum mechanics. Now, you don't have an explicit solution for these models, so the next best thing to an explicit solution is probably what is sometimes called the exact WKB method. So with the exact WKB method, you can actually address this model, and let me remind you that the exact WKB method is actually a combination of two different things. One of these things is the all-orders WKB system, which was already essentially invented in the 30s. And then you have to use some sort of resummation techniques, typically Borel-type resummation techniques, in order to make sense of the formal power series that appear in the all-orders WKB method. Because one has to remember that the all-orders WKB method gives you just formal power series. So the starting point for this formal power series is actually what I would call the quantum version of the Liouville 1 form. Now, usually in this method, you start with the standard Liouville 1 form, t times dx, and the WKB method gives you an extension of this one form to a full formal power series in powers of h bar, and this one form lives in the what I will call the WKB curve, which is just the curve of constant energy in phase space. Once you find this Liouville 1 form, you can, for example, write down wave functions by integrating them in this way. And of course, these wave functions are, again, formal power series. Now, the basic building blocks in order to obtain quantization conditions in the exact WKB method are the quantum periods and the Borov symbols. So how you construct them? Well, quantum periods are obtained as follows. Let gamma be a one cycle on this WKB curve, this constant energy curve in phase space. Now, you can integrate this quantum Liouville 1 form around this gamma 1 cycle, and this gives you a formal power series in H bar, which I'm going to call a quantum period. And Borel symbols are just exponentials of this quantum period with an overall factor I over H bar. Another important property of quantum periods is that they define a deformed version of a special geometry. So let me give you the example of the cubic oscillator, which is a simple example. So given an energy E, you can define two one cycles associated to the WKB curve. The A cycle is the cycle which goes around the minimum of the potential, and the B cycle is the cycle which goes around the tunneling region of the potential. Now, the A period, the quantum A period is defined by the integral of the quantum one form around the A cycle, and this you can take it as a coordinate A, and the quantum B period around the B cycle defines the derivative of a function, which I'm going to call quantum free energy, or Necrasio-Sartas-Vili free energy, which as we will see is the analog of the Necrasio-Sartas-Vili free energy for this kind of simpler setting of quantum mechanics. Now, the spectrum of Hamiltonians in this context can be determined by exact quantization conditions, and I put here the exact words in quotation marks for a reason that I will explain in a moment. Now, typically, the shape of these quantization conditions, of these exact quantization conditions, is a vanishing condition involving borrowed symbols. Let me give you again the example of the cubic oscillator. In this potential, you have an infinite tower of resonances, which are complex energy eigenvalues, and they can be determined by just considering this exact quantization condition, which involves the borrowed symbol associated to the A cycle and the borrowed symbol associated to the B cycle, with one coefficient here, S, which I will explain a little bit later. Now, if this doesn't look like a standard quantization condition, you can go to the perturbative limit in which you drop exponentially small corrections. Then the quantization condition looks like this, and it's very easy to see that if you restrict yourself to the leading order h-bar corrections, you get exactly the Bohr-Sommerfeld quantization condition for particles confined in this region of the potential. So the exact WKB method gives you all orders corrections to this Bohr-Sommerfeld condition in powers of h-bar, and it also gives you exponentially small corrections in h-bar to the perturbative conditions. Now, when you write things like this, you have to be very careful, because remember that I told you that quantum periods are formal power series. So this type of condition doesn't make any sense because you're working with formal power series, and if you want to make sense of them, you have to use a resummation method. So you have to actually choose a resummation method in order to make sense of these quantization conditions, or typically use some sort of Borel resummation. And one outcome of this is that the coefficients of this quantization condition depend on the resummation method that you choose. For example, in the case of the cubic oscillator, this coefficient can be 0 or 1 depending on the resummation direction that you choose. And in this sense, this can be regarded as a resurgent version of the Stokes phenomenon. So this is the price you have to pay when you work with formal power series in the exact WPB method. Your equations depend on resummation directions, and they display this version of the Stokes phenomenon. Now, of course, this method raises many obvious questions. Two questions that you could address once you are exposed to this method is the following. The first question concerns the perturbative structure of this method. So how you would calculate borrowed symbols, and what is the structure of these borrowed symbols? And there is also a more interesting non-perturbative question, which is the following. Can you find exact quantization conditions which involve actual functions, functions which are really well-defined and not this kind of resumed formal power series? And I will try to convince you in the rest of this talk that topological string theory has something interesting to say about both questions. So let me address the first question, which is the question of perturbative structure of these borrowed symbols. Now, in topological string theory, we like a lot to do perturbative calculations, and typically we are interested in calculating the perturbative series associated to the free energies. Now, this is a series which is labeled by the genus, and one of the most powerful methods to take this perturbative series is the BCOV holomorphic anomaly equations. Now, let me remind you some basic facts about these BCOV holomorphic anomaly equations. This is a recursive procedure, which is uses as initial data the genus 0 free energy and the genus 1 free energy. It needs boundary conditions. This is sometimes called the holomorphic ambiguity of the BCOV equations. But these ambiguities can be typically fixed when you work on a local Calabi-Yau-Mann. This procedure turns out to be extremely efficient if you combine it with modularity. When you express everything in terms of modular forms on your local geometries, or even in more general compact geometries, you can actually compute very efficiently the perturbative series, much more efficiently sometimes than in many other quantum systems. And another important fact is that also the BCOV equations were actually originally designed to compute the standard topological string partition functions, you can extend it to the refined topological string. Now, my first claim in how topological string is useful in quantum mechanics is that the Borov symbols for anharmonic oscillators are actually governed by the holomorphic anomaly equation. And I'm very happy to tell you this in the 25th anniversary of the VCUV anomaly equations, because I think this is a very interesting application to a very elementary problem, which is the calculation of WPV series in standard quantum mechanics. Now, in order to do this, you have to consider the refined version of the holomorphic anomaly equations, and also you have to consider the Necrasov-Satasvili limit of this refined version. One very interesting corollary of this claim is that Borov symbols are actually formal power series of modular forms in the WKB curve. And this can be checked very explicitly in Unus 1. So essentially, the way you do it, you consider this quantum free energy that is defined by the formal power series in H bar, and you promote its dependence on the modulus. In the case of Unus 1, there is a single modulus, to a non-holomorphic dependence, and you know that the holomorphic anomaly equations allow you to calculate these coefficients recursively in a very systematic way. And actually, for the problems that appear typically in Unus 1, like the cubic or the double well potential, this is the most efficient method to calculate the all-order WKB expansion in these quantum mechanical problems. So we did very precise tests in Unus 1. There was recent evidence that in Unus 2, this procedure also works. And what is also very interesting is that the holomorphic anomaly equations not only give you the perturbative structure of the series, but it can also be used to calculate exponentially small corrections to the series. You see, this series is actually a factorially divergent series. And whenever you see a factorially divergent series in quantum theory, you should suspect that there will be at least exponentially small corrections to it, what is called in resurgence theory a trans series. And it turns out that the holomorphic anomaly equations of VCOV can be promoted to the non-perturbative real by using a non-perturbative ansatz for the answer, and you can actually compute non-perturbative exponentially small corrections to these series. Now, this fact might be surprising to some of you, so let me give you some a priori explanation why the holomorphic anomaly equation governs standard quantum mechanics. And the reason why there is such a connection, or at least the simplest reason why there is such a connection, is because you can actually engineer anharmonic oscillators as a scaling limit of SUN cyberwitten theory near the Argyris-Douglas point. So this has been observed by many people, but let me give you a sort of a simple description of this. This can be seen very easily from the cyberwitten curve. So let me consider the cyberwitten curve of the SUN theory. Here we have a potential of degree n whose coefficients are the moduli of the cyberwitten moduli space. And there is a very special point in the cyberwitten moduli space of SUN theory, which is called the Argyris-Douglas point, where the lower energy effective theory is a superconformative theory. And near this point, you can actually do a very precise scaling of this moduli with particular conformal weights here, delta 2 up to delta n. And you can see very easily that in this scaling limit, the cyberwitten curve becomes just the WKB curve of an anharmonic oscillator in quantum mechanics. Now, this is the classical version of this scaling, and when you consider the quantum theory, you have to be careful, and you have also to scale the Planck constants appearing in the theory. So if you put this theory in the omega background with a Planck constant h-bar, and you want to recover standard quantum mechanics, you also have to scale the Planck constant in this way. So this is an a priori explanation, because we know that cyberwitten theory can be engineered in terms of topological string theory. There is this geometric engineering of cyberwitten theory in terms of topological strings. And as I just have shown you, there is an Argyris-Douglas scaling which engineers anharmonic oscillators as limits of cyberwitten theory. So now you can understand very well why the holomorphic anomaly goes all the way down to quantum mechanics, because the holomorphic anomaly controls perturbative expansions in topological string theory. This is inherited by cyberwitten theory, and this is in turn inherited by anharmonic oscillators in quantum mechanics. So this is an a priori explanation of this fact, but once you realize that anharmonic oscillators can be embedded in cyberwitten theory, you should look more carefully at the quantization of cyberwitten theory itself, because if we, one road, possible road to solve the quantization problem of anharmonic oscillators in quantum mechanics could be to embed them in Severin-Witten theory and then to try this Archimedes-Douglas scaling limit. So let me actually elaborate a little bit on that. Now, when you put Severin-Witten theory on this omega background and you quantize it, the first thing that you get quantized is the Severin-Witten curve itself. So the Severin-Witten curve was written as a curve in X and P space, but if you promote X and P to Heisenberg operators, you will get an operator of this form, and now you can think about what are the constraints on the parameters of this curve, such that you actually annihilate given stacing a given Hilbert space. Now, this problem can be reformulated as a standard eigenvalue problem in which you consider a Hamiltonian, which is actually very similar to the Hamiltonians that we see in quantum mechanics, and this actually gives you a deformation of a standard quantum mechanics in which the kinetic term of quantum mechanics gets promoted to a term involving exponentials. So this is clearly a deformation of quantum mechanics, and the potential gets undeformed. Now, the quantization of the Severin-Witten curve has been addressed in many papers, but here the differential aspect of our approach is that we are actually interested in the actual spectral problem solved by this Hamiltonian on the standard Hilbert space L2R. And as in standard quantum mechanics, if you want to address this spectral problem, you have to distinguish between N odd and N even, because this has very different flavor. Now, when N is odd, you have an unbounded potential, and you should expect to find resonant states with complex eigenvalues. So, for example, when N is equal to 3, this is the quantized Severin-Witten curve, and here you have a parameter H2, and this Hamiltonian should have complex eigenvalues, which are given by minus H3, where H3 is the Cartan modulus of Severin-Witten theory, which are functions of H2, and which are labeled by an integer N, which is labeling the level of the energy eigenstate. Now, when N is even, you should expect to have bound states. So, for example, when N is equal to 4, you have this sort of Hamiltonian, where now you will have real eigenvalues. This is a confining potential. So if H2 and H3 are real, you expect to have real eigenvalues, which are going to be functions of H2 and H3. Now, the important geometric aspect of this quantization is that this leads to a discrete family of codimension ones of manifolds in Severin-Witten moduli space. So each energy level gives you a codimension ones of manifold defined by this condition here or by this condition here in Severin-Witten moduli space. And this is actually very interesting, because if you are familiar with the integrable system called the total lattice, you have probably noticed that similar Hamiltonians appear in the Baxter equation, which was considered by Godin and Pasquier as a way to solve the total lattice. Now, when you solve the Baxter equation for solving the quantum total lattice, the boundary conditions that you impose on the eigenfunctions are very different and are much more restrictive. And actually, one of the outcomes of this analysis of Godin and Pasquier is that solutions for these eigenfunctions exist only for a discrete set of points in moduli space. And these discrete set of points give you actually the eigenvalues of the commuting Hamiltonians of the quantum total lattice. So here we have a different quantization problem in which you get a discrete set of points, while the quantization problem that I have defined before gives you a family of codimension ones of manifolds inside with the moduli space. Interestingly, one can show that the points defined by the quantum Hamiltonians of the total lattice belong to the submanifolds defined by our quantization condition. And actually, the existence of these total points in this quantum mechanical problem, it's very interesting, because at these points, interesting things happen in quantum mechanics, in this deformed version of quantum mechanics, that do not exist in the standard version of quantum mechanics. For example, if you tune the values of the parameters to these total lattice points, resonant states become bound states, and you can also have parity symmetry breaking. You can have symmetric potentials where you have a degeneracy of the ground state. And this is due, of course, to the fact that we are deforming standard quantum mechanics. And the existence of these total lattice points actually gives you new phenomena in this deformed version of quantum mechanics, which are not present in standard quantum mechanics. Now, why this deformation of quantum mechanics is interesting? Well, among other things, it's interesting because it's exactly solvable. One can write down exact quantization conditions for this deformed version of quantum mechanics given by the Severin-Witten curve for any potential. And the answer involves actual functions, so no resummation is needed. So let me explain you why this is so. Now, in principle, if you wanted to use the exact WPV method to solve this problem, the first thing you would have to do would be to compute the quantum periods and the Borov symbols associated to the cyber-Witten curve. Now, this is, of course, a well-known problem. These are just the quantum periods of the cyber-Witten curve. These are the periods that you compute in the cyber-Witten theory in the half omega background thing when you have turn on an H bar. So this gives you a deformation of the cyber-Witten differential, which is similar to the deformation of the Liouville 1 form that I was presenting before. And then you can calculate M minus 1 A periods and M minus 1 B periods, which gives you the Nekrasov-Satashvili free energy of this theory. So these are, in principle, the building blocks for this exact quantization method. But one very interesting consequence of the modern approach to the calculation of these quantities is that if you were doing a standard exact WPV method, these quantities would be formal power series in H-bar. Now, in instanton calculus, these are no longer formal power series. In instanton calculus, you do an expansion in the dynamical scale of the theory, and you, at each order in this dynamical scale, you resum all H-bar corrections in such a way that these two expansions are typically convergent. They have a finite radius of convergence. Now, alternatively, you can write TBA-like equations determining these functions, which are also define these functions, not as formal power series. So in other words, supersymmetric H theory gives you a natural resummation of the WKV expansion that you can use in order to solve this quantization problem. The exact quantization conditions that I will present involve these resum quantum periods. Now, remember that the quantization condition I'm giving and looking for is not the total lattice quantization condition. It should give me codimension ones of manifolds inside with the model space, and this means that they are going to be defined by the vanishing of a single function inside with the model space, in the same way that standard quantization conditions in standard quantization mechanics are given by the vanishing of some of a given function involving the Borov symbols, as I was showing you in the example of the cubic oscillator. Now, what is this function? Now, this involves solving the exact quantization problem for this model, and it turns out that the function can be explicitly calculated for any potential by using topological string theory. So, let me show you the answer. Let me focus first on n even. So, the quantization condition that you find is actually a sum of many terms. These terms are obtained as follows. We consider a very peculiar weight in the weight lattice of SUN, which is given by the alternating sum of the fundamental weights, and then you consider the Weyl orbit of this weight, so all weights obtained by Weyl reflections on this given weight. Now, each term in the Weyl orbit will give you one term in the exact quantization condition, and you now write the B periods as an element of the root lattice, the A periods as an element of the weight lattice, and you can see that this formula, where alpha are all the positive roots of SUN, is given by a sum of Borov symbols, and actually these Borov symbols are exponentials of quantum periods with integer coefficients, and the vanishing of this function defines a codimension, a set of discrete codimension ones of manifolds in model space, which are supposed to be the solutions to the quantization problem I'm considering. Now, there is a similar story for n odd, in which you have an extra term. And the first thing you have to check is that this quantization condition is actually correct. And it turns out that this quantization condition can actually lead you to concrete results. So let me actually give you an example. All checks we have made give us complete agreement between this quantization condition and numerical calculation of the spectrum. So let me give you a very simple example. Let's consider this particular quantization of the SU4 cyber-Witten curve, so where I choose these coefficients. So the potential is a standard double well, but I have before the kinetic term. You can compute the energy levels of this quantum model numerically. These are the results we get for the ground state and the fundamental state. Notice that these numbers are very close because the splitting between these two levels is an instanton effect. You can then compare these numerical results with the predictions of this quantization condition. You can compute the energies with this quantization condition in two ways. You can use either the TBA integral equations, which give you results on the nose, identical to the numerical results, or you can compute the quantum periods as a sum over instantons, and the more instantons you include, the closer you get to the actual result. So you see that the instant non-series gives you a convergent result to the energies. So this is actually the exact potential condition that converts this theory. And as I said, this is a prediction of topological string theory for this deformed quantum mechanical model. So how would you derive this quantization condition? I cannot give you all the details, but the main idea is they have to use this topological string spectral theory correspondence, which relates conjecturally the spectral properties of quantum mirror curves to the VPS invariance of torical Abelian manifolds. So the idea is that you take the Cyber-Witten theory, you use geometric engineering to derive it from a quantum mirror curve, you find the quantization conditions for this mirror curve, and then you take this four-dimensional limit in which you get quantization conditions for Cyber-Witten theory. And as I said, this is, since this problem can be solved with this TSST correspondent, you can solve this deformed problem in Cyber-Witten theory. Now, let me give you at least one extra ingredient in this quantization condition, which I think is very interesting. So as I said, this quantization condition for the Cyber-Witten curve can be obtained from the topological string theory. And it's very interesting that this term here comes from perturbative WKB for the quantum mirror curve. So this is, in a sense, a purely perturbative term. While this term here, which involves a science, this actually comes from Gopakumar-Bapha invariance of the underlying topological string theory. So you know that these theories are engineered by Calabi-Yau. We have an AN singularity, and they have a sequence of Gopakumar-Bapha invariants associated to the positive roots of the Calabi-Yau, and this gives you on the nose this non-perturbative term. So here's an example in which Gopakumar-Bapha invariants in this Calabi-Yau give you non-perturbative information about quantum mechanical models in this quantized Cyber-Witten curve. And it's also interesting to remark that the quantization conditions that determine the total lattice points, which were obtained by Nekrasov and Satasvili, only require this perturbative information. You can actually write them in this way, the exponential of this weight vector times a basic root is equal to -1 for all possible basic roots. One can check that the points satisfying this condition also satisfy this quantization condition, but the difference between these two is that here you have non-extra non-perturbative information, which comes from the standard topological string on the Calabi-Yau. So now once you have done all this, you can ask, well, how do we go to standard quantum mechanics? Because after all, what I explained to you before is that you can engineer harmonic oscillators in terms of Cyber-Witten theory. If you want to do that, you will face a very interesting difficulty. The difficulty is that the instanton sum expressing the quantum periods converges very badly near the Argyris-Douglas points. The Argyris-Douglas points are deep in moduli space, and the instanton sums that you use to calculate quantum periods in this Cyber-Witten theory are actually tailored for semi-classical expansions at the large values of the moduli. So it's not completely straightforward to deduce exact quantization conditions for quantum mechanics from the exact quantization conditions from the quantum Cyber-Witten curve. The fact, however, that one can actually, in some cases, write exact quantization conditions for quantum mechanics in terms of integral equations suggests that there should be a connection between the TVA form of our exact quantization conditions and the integral equations that people have found for some quantum mechanical models. Now, this actually raises a general problem that I think is an interesting open problem, and it's quite general, and it's the following. Instanton calculus and topological vertex computations were, in a sense, an analytical triumph because they lead from asymptotic expansions to expansions which were, in some cases, convergent. And this is what actually is behind this analytical power of these instanton sums for topological vertex calculations are the underlying reasons why you can actually solve many spectral problems exactly. But these expansions are tailored to semi-classical regions, to large radius regions in the case of the Calabi-Yau, and to semi-classical regions in the case of this theory. So I think one of the main questions is, are there other resummations, are similar resummations of the string coupling expansion or H-bar expansion in other regions of moduli space, and what are the techniques that one can use to find it? Because among other things, if we were actually able to find such a resummation near our Argyris-Douglas point, one could actually use this Argyris-Douglas scaling to find a new quantization condition for standard quantum mechanics. So this analysis in terms of topological string theory also gives you some sort of very interesting point of view on quantum mechanics. Now, if you quantize mirror curves, this means that you are considering operators which involve Weyl operators, exponentials of the Heisenberg operators. And then life is easy there. And actually, life is so easy there that just using standard topological vertex calculations gives you all the spectrum. Now, when you go to quantum cyber-Witten curve, you keep one of the exponential operators. One operator is still a Weyl operator, but then you go from e to x to x, e to the x to e to x. And then this is moderately easy. This is the problem that I showed you before. You can still write exact quantization conditions, but you have to be careful because sometimes your energy levels will land in regions in moduli space which are far from the semi-classical region, and then convergence will be very, very slow. And then standard quantum mechanics, from this point of view, is hard because this is where you have to actually go directly to the superconformal point, to the AD point, and this is where you expect this instanton calculus to be less reliable. So, in a sense, you know, it would have been much better if quantum mechanics was formulated in terms of Weyl operators instead of standard Heisenberg operators. Now, let me conclude. So, the 100-year-old problem of solving quantum and harmonic oscillators can be addressed in the context of topological string theory. I think this is an unexpected application, in a sense. And, for example, one can actually calculate Borel symbols using the holomorphic anomaly equation. Now, there is an intermediate stage between topological strings and ordinary quantum mechanics. And this is the quantization of the cyber-Witten curve. And this provides a deformation of quantum mechanics, which is still exactly solvable and displays some interesting new phenomenon. And I think this is also interesting because it gives you a new testing ground for this correspondence between topological streams and spectral theory. In a sense, the spectral problem is relatively simpler because at least you have one operator which is a standard Heisenberg operator. And of course, many generalizations are possible because I have here considered cyber-Witten theory with gauge group SUN and no matter, but you can consider adding matter content gauge groups and see what are the kind of spectral problems that you find. All of them should be solvable with the TSST correspondence. And solving quantum mechanical oscillators now can be formulated in this context as you would have a solution to the problem of quantum mechanical oscillators if you could have an exact determination of the quantum periods of cyber-Witten theory near the superconformal point. So in a sense, quantum mechanics and the physics of AD points in cyber-Witten theory turns out to be very closely related. So with this, let me finish. Thank you very much for your attention.